Thank you. Good morning and welcome to worship at Chelmsford Salvation Army. Our service today is led by our core officers, Majors Ian and Tracey Mountford. The theme for today, Remembrance Sunday, is Lest We Forget, and we look forward to God speaking to us through His Word later. But first, just a few announcements. As you will all be aware, we've now entered the period of the second national lockdown, which means there will be no resumption of gathered worship until December at the earliest. We hope, however, to be able to open the hall at certain times for private prayer in accordance with COVID safe guidelines, and further announcements will be made about this in due course. Food parcel deliveries are, however, continuing during this period, and the refurbishment works on our charity shop are now almost complete. However, as this is deemed as non-essential retail, the shop will not be able to open again just yet, but should be ready to do so as soon as restrictions are lifted. We'd ask, therefore, that if you have any donations for the shop, that you hang on to them until the shop is open again and do not bring them to the hall. We're still working through the implications for our toy appeal this year. Further guidance will be available shortly as to how we can safely receive your gifts so that we can support those children in need within our community, as we have done for so many years. Please continue to pray for the families of June Jarvis and Eric Collett, whose funerals are next week, and indeed continue to pray for all those on our prayer list. On Saturday the 5th of December at 6 p.m, our virtual Christmas worship will premiere on this channel. It's organised, as always, by our Songsters and is entitled Mary's Journey. Please share details of this service to family and friends via social media. As we continue our worship now, our prayer time will be led by Major Tracey Mountford.
Let us pray. Father God, we thank you that you hear our prayers. We pray for this Remembrance Sunday, for those who have served or serve to keep our freedom and safety, for those who have paid the ultimate price with their lives for others in service. We pray for those whose loved ones are serving abroad currently, and we ask your peace and protection upon them. We pray too for our country, as we are now in these new pandemic restrictions for the next few weeks. May we shine out as a light for you, demonstrating goodness, love and concern for others. We pray that these restrictions may make some difference in coronavirus case lowering. We pray for those in isolation that you will give your patience, and for those with the virus, and we ask for your healing in Jesus' name. We pray for your peace, for the lonely and the isolated, and for those whose mental health is being affected. We trust you for our every day, and ask this day, as we worship you together online, that you will bless us, use us for good, shape our lives and ministry as we each seek you this day. Amen.
Thank you. reading from Micah chapter 4. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of the mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and people will stream to it. Many nations will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, so that we may walk in his paths." The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between many peoples and will settle disputes for strong nations far and wide. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war any more. Everyone will sit under their own vine and under their own fig tree, and no one will make them afraid, for the Lord Almighty has spoken. All the nations may walk in the name of their gods, but we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. Has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other.
Thank you. Good morning. It was Santillana. Santillana was a Spanish philosopher who said these words: "Those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it." In other words, what he was saying was, if we do not learn from past mistakes and missed opportunities, we will soon be going over the same old ground time and time again. Well, stopping to remember and pausing for moments of silence has many different origins. And when the 2 minutes of silence was introduced on Remembrance Sunday in 1919 by King George, he was embracing a practice that had already started in churches as early as 1916. A practice that not only allowed for the remembrance of the dead and those missing in action, but also gave an opportunity to pause and to think about the very cost of war itself. To think about our own need for repentance, and to think about the need to continually strive towards peace. Well, that tradition has carried on for generations. And for those of us who have a family history connected to the loss of loved ones in war, or for those of us who have family or friends currently serving in the armed forces, it remains both a poignant and significant day. We will remember. But it is easy for us to forget. It is easy for us to fail to remember. By the very act of setting aside time to remember today, we are seeking not to forget. Not forgetting the loss of life, the sacredness of life, the cost of war, both human, material, and environmental, the victims of aggression, be they military or civilian, the long-term impact of conflict, physically, mentally, generationally, and the place of freedom and the desire for peace. We will remember. I wonder how many of us often repeat past mistakes because we've forgotten what led to them, or we've forgotten the choices we made, or the failure to make a choice. Well, as we enter another lockdown in England, we are faced with many questions about how the pandemic is being handled. What lessons are being learned? What are we doing differently that might avert some of the challenges we faced earlier in the year? And the reality is that it's not only the government that is sometimes slow in learning from past mistakes, but we ourselves are often guilty of it as well. Part of the culture in dealing with such things is that we fail to listen, we fail to remember, we fail to recall, we fail to learn from past mistakes. It's in Micah chapter 4, verses 1 to 5, which in some respects is a mirror image of Isaiah chapter 2, verses 1 to 4, where we see a picture of a kingdom that is established because it is a learning community. It's one that is both built on the law and revealed, that we know now is revealed in through the covenant of Jesus Christ. But it's also one that is prophetic in terms of living life under the rule and oracle of God and God alone. It is a place of freedom. It's a place of peace, where people live equally and equitably. They live peacefully with one another. It's where they have learned from the former things, and where the concept of conflict and war is remolded into a shared garden of tranquility, where none might be afraid and where all nations might walk together in security because of the faithfulness of God and God alone. Well, that image seems a long way off from the world in which we live today. But that word is prophetic. It's a picture of what life looks like when it comes under the rule and reign of Jesus Christ. Micah went out barefoot and naked in his mourning and wailing because of the incurable sin and sickness of Judah. He took serious the need to learn from past mistakes and to honor the sanctity of human life. And his noble vision of nations not taking up sword against nations is today seen as a biblical idea of peace. Education is also part of that prophetic vision, part of the glorious age depicted by Micah. It's a reminder that the instructions that God has given for life go beyond intellectual understanding, beyond our own comprehension of particular situations, to a deeper level of seeing things through kingdom eyes, learning as we walk in his path. Verse 2 reminds us that the starting point for all of this is prayer. A personal encounter with God on his holy mountain in his temple enables us to encounter God with our concerns so that he might teach us his ways and that we might walk in his paths. Last Sunday, approximately 30 of us met here in the hall, and we focused on the theme of faith, hope, and love as we gathered together for prayer. It seemed like an appropriate way to begin to take tentative steps back towards corporate worship. And although as a result of lockdown that might not now be possible until December, the door has opened for us to open the hall for individual prayer. And this is something that we will be doing from next week. The hall has been risk assessed. It's a COVID safe venue. And under the government guidelines, individuals can come and pray in the hall, praying privately and praying personally. Imagine the strength in that when the focus of our hall becomes set aside solely for the purpose of prayer. Well, you and I can pray at home, but I think there's also something very special and something significant on a spiritual level when brothers and sisters in Christ pray, albeit individually, but on the same ground. So for next week, we will be opening the doors 3 days a week to anyone who wants to come and pray privately in the hall. And you'll be able to find more details of that on our Facebook and webpage. If Micah 4 is a prophetic vision of what is possible through Jesus Christ and his kingdom, then John chapter 15 and the description of the vine and the branches is evidence of how that kingdom is at work. In it, we find a verse that's so often recalled on Remembrance Day. The picture found of the great chapter of love, the one of Jesus laying down his life, and the reminder that the sacredness of life is a gift, and that for some, laying it down for others is not only a demonstration of love, but it's also the greatest mark of true friendship. Jesus Christ, the love of God incarnate, is the vine that nurtures and sustains all life. In him, we see the importance of life, we see the value of life, and we see the purpose of life. This is a picture of a church remaining in communion with him. And for the Salvationist, that communion is a life lived out through prayer and service. Albert Osborne wrote, "My life must be Christ's broken bread." And when he wrote it, reflecting upon that and the cost of war and its impact, reflecting upon it, he said that on his visit to Berlin in 1947, when he met German Salvation Army officers in the war-damaged, poverty-stricken Berlin, in the war-damaged Berlin Citadel, he said this: "I was burdened with a sense of my own inadequacy to match the occasion. I cried to God to help me in my own spirit and to let his spirit work within us all, to bring us together, to bridge what seemed to be in all reason an impossible gulf between our respective conditions of living. And God revealed to me that not only that day but always we have no hope of being a blessing to other souls unless our lives become a part of the Saviour's sacramental consecration. And before I left Berlin, this song had begun to form in my mind. And as I travelled towards Holland along the straight but monotonous autobahn, line by line, the song was given to me, the last verse coming in the early morning, following my return home. My life must be Christ's broken bread." But also the Salvationist prayer to be like Jesus finds its utter fulfillment in sacramental living, demonstrating Christ's life and love through doing his teachings. And we are challenged to be the third person who tells the stories of God and who breaks and shares everything so that our lives might be Christ's broken bread. If the world is to find healing, then it is through Jesus. If the world is to find peace, it is through Christ. If the world is to find hope, then it is revealed in the way you and I communicate that gospel through our living and through our praying. Our faith, our hope, and our love will not only help us to remember and learn, but help us also to step out and up for such a time as this, in order to face the current battles and to minister the gospel of peace. Earlier, we were reminded of the words of Fanny Crosby in the hymn, "Draw Me Nearer." Consecrate me now to thy dear service, Lord. By the power of grace divine, let my soul look up with steadfast hope and my will be lost in thine. O, the pure delight of a single hour that before thy throne I spend, when I kneel in prayer with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. There are depths of love that I cannot know. Till I cross the narrow sea, there are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. For Micah, for the Apostle John, for Jesus, for Albert Osborne and for Fanny Crosby, the starting point in remembrance was always prayer. So as you remember today, may you also walk with him. May you learn from him. And may his sacrifice challenge and remind you of just how important you are. Before we share in an act of remembrance together, we're going to listen to the band who will remind us through music of that love. Such love, pure as the whitest snow. Such love that weeps for the shame I know. Such love, paying the debt I owe. O Jesus, such love. Let us share together in an act of remembrance. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? As we gather together but apart, we remember. As we remember, we reflect. As we reflect, we also repent of our own failure to do justice, to love kindness and to walk humbly with our God. As we stand in silence, we come before God to remember, to reflect, to offer our own repentance. O God of truth and justice, we hold before you those whose memory we cherish and those whose names we will never know. Help us to lift our eyes above the torment of this broken world and grant us the grace to pray for those who wish us harm. As we honour the past, may we put our faith in you, for you are the source of life and hope, both now and forever. They shall not grow old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
Thank you.
our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And our benediction. Father, keep us mindful of those who continue to suffer from war and unrest. May you reach out in your mercy. May we be a people who seek to demonstrate peace, love and acceptance for one another. May your grace, your peace and your love flow in and through us, now and forevermore, we pray. Amen.